Well, so there's a couple ways to think about it, but let me just kind of go top down. So here's what I'm thinking. I think the same principle applies, where you sort of want to ask the question that gives you the maximum amount of information. And from the teacher's point of view, I might be able to pick a question that gives you the answer right away, depending upon what H is and what X is. But from the learner's point of view, I sort of can't. So what does the learner know?
So when we ask a question X, it's going to either have a yes answer or no answer. And let's say that at any given point in time, we have N possible people that we're trying to reason about. And then after we choose X, after we choose the question, if the answer is yes, then we're going to have, I don't know, some other number of people, say L. And if the answer is no, then it's going to be N minus L, right? And so you said that in the case of the teacher, pick a question so that this yes is going to whittle it down so that this is just going to be the one right answer.
That's exactly right. That's assuming that X is set up in such a way that you could ask that kind of question.
Basically, a question can be of the form, is it this or this or this or this or this? Any pattern of answers that we want, we can construct the corresponding question.
Okay, that makes sense to me, and I don't think it changes my thought process, so that's good. So I always want to ask a question that's going to give me maximal information. I'm the learner. I don't know everything like the teacher does, but what I do know are all of my hypotheses, right? So I know how each hypothesis responds to each of the questions. So in general, it seems to me that I should try to eliminate as many hypotheses as I can. Okay? Does that make sense?
Yeah, I'll write that down. I like that.
Now, you could say that's what the teacher did, but let's take what the teacher did. The teacher knew that there was a hypothesis where it would whittle it down, that it, since the answer was yes, it would whittle it down to one. But if the answer had been no, it would have only gotten rid of one. So since the teacher knew the answer, the teacher could pick that question. But as a learner, I don't know the answer. So finding questions that whittle it down to one, if the answer is yes, aren't very helpful because the answer might be no.
All right, so how many, let's see. So under the assumption the target hypothesis was chosen from H, say, uniformly at random.
Right.
What's the expected number of hypotheses we can eliminate with a question that has this form?
Well, it's binary. So if you assume that the hypothesis space covers everything, then the best you can do is eliminate about half of them on average.
Well, so, but in particular, if you have a question like this, X, that, you know, you ask it when there's N possible people, and then after you ask it, if the answer is yes, you're at L possible people, and otherwise you're at N minus L, which branch are we going to go down?
Well, we don't know. It could be either one.
Aha, but can we put a probability on it?
Yes, if it covers everything, it's about a half and a half. You said it was uniform, right? Uniformly chosen?
The right answer, the target person is uniformly chosen, but this question isn't necessarily of that form, right? This question could be very skewed. It might only have one thing on the left and N minus one on the right, like you said.
Right. Well, then that's not a very good question to ask.
No, that's right. But I want to be able to distinguish good from bad questions by saying we want questions that are going to leave us with the smallest expected size set.
Oh, well then, since all possibilities are there, the smallest, the best you can hope for is about a half.
Yeah, and in particular, what this particular question is going to do is it's going to have a probability of N over L of going down the left branch and getting an L, and it's going to have a probability of N minus L over N of going down the right branch and getting N minus L, and so that could be one way of actually scoring this question. The question that has the best score, as you pointed out, is going to be one where L is about the same as N minus L. In fact, half would be a really good choice.
Right. I thought that's what I said.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, good.
But I just wanted to write down the formula.
Oh, okay. That makes sense. Okay. No, it's always good to write down the formula. Okay, so you want to pick questions that roughly split things in half. And if you can do that every single time, then every single time you will split the set in half. So you'll start out with N, then N over 2, then N over 4, then N over 8, then N over... And eventually you'll get to N over N, which will give you 1. So you'll only have 1 possible answer. And so that'll take you a logarithm amount of time.
Right. So the number of times you can divide a number in half before you get down to 1 is exactly the log base 2. So if we start out with size of H hypotheses, it'll take us like log base 2 to whittle it down to a single question. This is a lot larger. I mean, this is a nice small number, but it's a lot larger than 1, right? You know, 1 is really great. This is... You know, exponentially, no. This is much, much worse than 1. But it's still really good. It's not considering all the hypotheses. It's very cleverly whittling it down so that it only has to look at the log of that.
Right.